All right, welcome to Egypt. We're going to take a look at how the Egyptians fused together their religion and political philosophy into their government. And this is completely unique for the times. All right, I want you to title this Egypt, the Gift of the Nile. What comes to mind when you think of Egypt? Pyramids. All right. Now, in order to build those huge structures, they needed a great deal expertise in mathematics, science, engineering. All right. And they want to put all these skills together in order to build these huge structures that have stood the test of time. Also, domesticated the cat. Hey. Now, if you look here on this map I have, okay, the Nile actually flows from the interior of Africa to the Mediterranean Sea. And that would make Lower Egypt here and Upper Egypt here, okay? And these are going to exist as two separate kingdoms for almost 2,000 years, all right? Lower Egypt and Upper Egypt. Now, if you look on either side of the Nile, you see desert. Okay? Here and here. Desert. Even on the other side of the Red Sea, desert. So, because they were surrounded by desert, they were protected from outside invaders. Now, this graph shows, right, when it flooded. And based on flood times of the Nile, they were able to plan the rest of the year because the Nile flooded predictably at the exact same time every year. Okay? And so they knew when to harvest, they knew when to plant, and they knew when to leave because it was getting ready to flood. Alright? And that's going to stabilize Egyptian society. Alright, I got a little excerpt from a hymn to the Nile. I want you to read it and answer the question about the importance of the Nile to the Egyptians. Okay, let's talk about dynasty. Dynasty is a family of rulers. That is, Egypt is going to be one of the first ones to set up a true dynasty. Alright, they had a leader named Menes, or sometimes referred to as Har, who is going to, he came from Upper Egypt, and he conquered Lower Egypt and unite the two as one, okay, bringing them together as one empire. And this begins, he's going to establish his new base of operations right here in Memphis, all right, so close to the Mediterranean Sea. So now this is where his new capital is going to be. My hometown, Memphis, Tennessee. Okay, now look over here. Going back to the word dynasty. Now, when he set this up, the key thing that he's going to do as Pharaoh is he's going to pass his power to his eldest son. Okay, so that there was no conflict. Power just passed from one father to the eldest son, all right, and this further stabilized Egyptian society. Okay. Now, Ramses the Great is probably considered the most accomplished pharaoh of all pharaohs, and that's because he was more of a warrior pharaoh. He's going to be concerned with expanding the border of Egypt, and he's going to expand it into parts of Mesopotamia. Okay, here's the Euphrates, Tigris, and he's also going to move down into the area of what we know as the Kush Empire, right? And so he's expanding the empire to its greatest lengths. And he was extremely concerned with immortality. He had over 100 children. to make sure that his name lived on. That is a lot of baby mamas. Let's take a look at Egyptian nobility, a closer look. Pharaohs are what we call God kings. That is, they were both God here on earth and king of the empire. All right, that means they were the center of the religion and the head of government. We call that a theocracy. All right, and they were a true theocracy. Now, like Iran today, Iran is a theocracy, but the leader is not God. He is a representative of God, like they do in Mesopotamia. All right, in Egypt, your leader was God. All right, made him more powerful. They were extremely concerned with the afterlife, and this had to do with the spirit called the Ka. You wanted to protect it so that it could live, and the person who was in charge of this would have been the scribe. I'm sorry, the high priest. The high priest was concerned with, his first concern was making the tomb, okay? That is the pyramid. So he designed and oversaw the making of the tomb. He did, would be in control of what went in it, what it looked like, where it was at, okay? And once the God King died, he was concerned with, all right, that is protecting the body so that it could live eternally. If you look here, this this mummy is over 2,000 years old, and it still, the skin is intact. Okay. I put you in the ground tomorrow. Within 10 years, you will be ashes to ashes, dust to dust. Okay? Now, again, the afterlife. Religion was the focus of their society. And because religion and afterlife was the focus of their society, everything centered around, here's Anubis. Anubis was the god over the afterlife. He's weighing a heart. If the heart is too heavy, that is heavier than a feather, you didn't make it. Okay? So everything they did was about getting to this afterlife. And this is going to be hugely influential, not only on the Egyptians, but on groups in their borders, right, like the Hebrews. Now the next group are the scribes. Now the scribes were like the biographers of the Egyptian royal family. They would have written down everything that happened of importance to the pharaoh. Now their writing style is something that we call hieroglyphs. Okay, it was a picture-based writing, and it's extremely complicated. One of the most complicated systems that we know of. Now, with 700 phonetic symbols, okay, not everyone knew the language or knew how to read and write. They also invented something called papyrus. Okay, extremely inventive people. Now, looking here, what they did is they took these dry reeds here, and I mean these reeds, and they're going to dry them out and turn it into something that is paper-like. Okay, it's quite a bit thicker than paper, but it was paper-like and allowed them to be able to write on it. It's going to be a huge improvement over what the Mesopotamians were doing with tablets, and the Chinese with okay, here's the number system. Now, their number system, again, based on 10, just like the Mesopotamians, okay? It was possibly culturally diffused from Mesopotamia to Egypt. Now, if you look here at the numbering system, can you figure out what this number is right here? Now, the reason that we're able to understand the hieroglyph is because of something called the Rosetta Stone, discovered by Napoleon, well, not Napoleon himself, Napoleon's army. He's going to go to Egypt to push the British out, and while he was there in the late 1690s, he's going to also bring a team of scientists with him, and one of them is going to uncover the Rosetta Stone. Now, the stone was most interesting because it had Egyptian hieroglyphs on it, and it also, down here at the bottom, had Greek writing. That Greek writing is what going to allow them to be able to unlock the code of the hieroglyphs. Now, let's take a look at the last couple of groups here. Artisans and farmers. This is where most people would have wound up. And for the most society was involved with the producing of grain, okay? It's food, all right? You had fishermen, and you also had blacksmiths, but most people were involved with the production of food. Each was going to be so blessed with a surplus that they're going to not only be able to feed their people, they're of Greece and Rome later on when those two empires come to conquer. Let's look at the pyramids now, or what we call the tomb for the pharaohs. All right, now this is what they are most known for. These tombs, if you take a look at this first one, all right, this is called the Step Pyramid, and it looks a lot like what a ziggurat was built like. All right, and it's possible that cultural diffusion. That is, they saw the ziggurat and they copied it because the ziggurat came first. But over time, they got better at what they were making. Unlike the ziggurat, this is only used for the tomb of the pharaoh. All right, no other business happens here. Just a tomb for the pharaoh. And as you see, over time, they got better and they also got more creative. Okay. Again, but it required a great deal of effort to produce these. We still do not know how they did it. But we do know it required a great deal of manpower. Okay, and if they were all involved in the producing of tombs, pyramids, what were the women? Okay, women of Egypt lived a better life in comparison to than say their Egyptian, I'm sorry, their European and Mesopotamian counterparts. All right. If you were a peasant, more than likely you'd been in home or farming. The key question that you might have is, were there any women pharaohs? All right, and it was very rare for a woman to become pharaoh, but
in 1903, British archaeologist Howard Carter was working in a tomb in the Valley of the Kings. Sifting through the sand, Carter came across a tomb, and on it the name of the pharaoh, Hatshepsut. Hatshepsut had been wiped from historical records for a very simple reason. This remarkable pharaoh was a woman. Early in her life, Hatshepsut had been an ordinary queen. When her husband died, her stepson Thutmosis came to the throne. But he was too young to rule alone, so Hatshepsut ruled as co-regent. This was not exceptional. What was shocking was her next step. Hatshepsut declared herself pharaoh. Only two women had been pharaoh before Hatshepsut, and both had failed to rule for long. But this did not deter her. She believed Egypt could be persuaded to accept a woman on the throne. After all, women in Egypt were held in high regard compared with other cultures of the time, as ancient texts reveal.
I hereby make my will for my wife. I leave her all of the property which I inherited from my
brother. Don't give your wife grief at home when you know that she's in control. Never say, where is it, find it for me, when she has put something where it's supposed to be.
Keep your eyes open, but keep your mouth shut. If you appreciate her quality...
You were better off as a woman in ancient Egypt than in most ancient societies. But it was very difficult for them to branch out independently, had their own careers. It was still a man's world. Egyptian women were known as Lady of the House, or if you like, housewife. Hatshepsut is no housewife.
Despite the rights women possessed at the time, Egyptians struggled with the idea of a female pharaoh. It went against the natural order of life, a concept Egyptians described as Maat.
Okay, so that was the first real female pharaoh. And really, definitely the most powerful female pharaoh. Now, there was another pharaoh of importance. His name was Akhenaten. He tried to change the religion of ancient Egypt from polytheism to monotheism, but he's going to fail. Now, he's more famous for his son, who I can never say his name, Tutankhamun, all right? Better known, you probably have seen him, known as King Tut. Definitely the most famous pharaoh of all time. And I'm not, it's puzzling why he's so famous, because he died at such a young age. He wasn't able to accomplish much as pharaoh. Here he is being excavated from his tomb. Howard Carter was the British archaeologist that discovered the tomb. All right, King Tut. Now, King Tut. All right, a lot of people wonder what he would have looked like. And as far as we can see, he would have looked something like, okay. He was from Lower Egypt, which means he would have been of a lighter hue. Maybe not this light, but he would have been of a lighter hue. And, outside of that, we don't know much about King Tut. He didn't live long. But let's look at the contributions of ancient Egypt. Okay, and again, I want you to take a look over here. Notice they have all of the necessities of a great empire or civilization. Okay, advanced technology, record keeping, complex institutions, specialized workers, and huge cities. All right, and these are some of their other achievements here. Now I got a few questions I want you to answer, and that concludes our look at ancient Egypt. Okay, great artist MJ, he did a ode to ancient Egypt. Just wanted to take you back for a second. Here it is.